Hello, my name is Ed Scheinerman. I am the Vice Dean for Graduate Education in the Whiting School of Engineering here at Johns Hopkins University, and it's my pleasure to talk to you today about the Doctor of Engineering degree program. This program, designed for mid-career engineering professionals, stands in parallel to our PhD program. To begin, let's talk a little bit about why we started this program in the first place. There are many working engineers who would like to get a PhD in engineering, but they can't. Why can't they? Well, they're in the middle of their careers. Perhaps they have a house payment. They've got a kid who needs braces. They're earning a good living. They've got a car payment. And now, are they going to suddenly drop all that, move to Baltimore, spend 6 years on our campus, earning a PhD? For most mid-career professionals, that's a complete non-starter. They're too embedded in their current lives to drop everything and become a graduate student. So instead, we have charted out an alternative path, which we call the Doctor of Engineering. The Johns Hopkins Doctor of Engineering degree program serves a new category of students with a new kind of degree program. It is professionally focused. It has mentored research as its centerpiece. It is a full-time program while being non-residential, and students are sponsored by their corporation or agency. Let's begin by looking at the similarities and differences between a PhD program and a Doctor of Engineering program. Let's start with what the core feature is of both, and that is mentored research. In both the PhD and the DEng degree, research is the key component of one's studies under the close tutelage of a faculty mentor here at Johns Hopkins. But from there, the programs diverge. PhD programs were designed for future academics, so the philosophy of PhD program is scholarship. Now, many of our PhD students do not go on to become professors. They take their careers in government or in industry, but nonetheless, we designed the PhD program many years ago for the future scholar in mind. As we conceived of the Doctor of Engineering degree, however, we realized that most of our Doctor of Engineering students are already working professionals who may not be interested in becoming academics. So we focused the Doctor of Engineering degree on problems involving engineering practice. The students in a PhD program are typically young. They're early in their career. They're many of them directly out of their undergraduate program, and they come to live in Baltimore 4 or 5, maybe even 6 years as they pursue their studies. Whereas the Doctor of Engineering students, who are typically mid-career, are not going to necessarily come to Baltimore. They live all over the globe. So it is a non-residential program for someone in the middle of their career, which I define as loosely 25 to age 75, but if you're outside that range, we'll certainly consider you as well. The home base of a PhD student is typically in a department. So PhD students get a degree in mechanical engineering or in civil engineering, whereas the Doctor of Engineering students are considered to be students at large in the School of Engineering, drawing from all our departments, because many of the Doctor of Engineering projects are transdisciplinary, drawing from many different disciplines. PhD students come to us fully funded, typically on government grants. PhD students do not pay for their degree. Rather, the tuition and stipend is covered on those grants. For Doctor of Engineering students, again, Doctor of Engineering students do not pay for their degree. Instead, their employer pays for their degree. And later in this presentation, I'll explain how that works and the rationale behind that approach. PhD students come to us with a bachelor's degree in hand. We require them to take the GRE exam and submit the usual letters of recommendation and so forth. For Doctor of Engineering, the admissions requirement includes a master's degree and experience in the workplace. PhD students typically do not have an industrial sponsor. It's possible, but that's pretty rare. However, for Doctor of Engineering students, an industrial or agency sponsor is central to how we work the program and is expected. Now, an interesting thing is how doctoral students in the PhD and DEng programs report the fruits of their research. For the PhD, that's done with a classical dissertation. So students write a book. We call that book a dissertation or a thesis, but make no mistake, they're writing books because, after all, that's what academics do. However, working professional engineers don't necessarily write books. They do all sorts of other activities, and so we allow our Doctor of Engineering students to be much more creative in how they describe the results of their research. They can do that in what we call their research portfolio, which can include such things as journal articles, patent applications, video, computer simulations, working prototypes, and the like. And so instead of defending a dissertation in a classic form, they defend their portfolio, which contains evidence of their research accomplishments. Coursework in a PhD program is typically happens in the first few years. New PhD students take a lot of courses because many of them are fresh out of their undergraduate program and they've got a lot to learn before they're ready to dive into research. With Doctor of Engineering students, we assume that those students are ready to hit the ground running and come in and get to work almost immediately on their research program. So we don't expect them to need much coursework, but if they do, they'll take whatever they want as needed. A typical PhD student takes about 5 years to complete their degree, and we have designed the Doctor of Engineering program to be much shorter. We expect our students to finish in about 3 years. So this image shows how we envision the structure of the Doctor of Engineering program. We see the Doctor of Engineering program as a research collaboration. So instead of thinking of it as take classes, pass exams, get your degree, rather the whole program is based on a research collaboration between Johns Hopkins engineering professors and the company where the student works. In some sense, the student is almost incidental to this collaboration. The Hopkins faculty and the company are working on a project that's of mutual interest. The student who is getting the degree, in some sense, does the work, but also serves as the glue between the company and Hopkins Engineering. Indeed, students in the Doctor of Engineering program get a primary advisor who is a Hopkins Engineering professor, but also a co-advisor, someone with research credentials back in their home agency. And those two people serve as their co-advisors. As I mentioned, it's a 3-year program, so what I would like to do now is to take a closer look at how those 3 years are structured. We're going to actually start with the year before the student enters the program, because that's an important part of the process. We call that year zero. That's what's happening in the year before a student enrolls with us. Every Doctor of Engineering student has a project. Now, for a PhD student, the project is something that their advisor hands to them. So a PhD student shows up on campus, they meet their advisor, the advisor says, "Welcome to my laboratory, here's the project you're going to be working on," and the student gets to work on that project. We invert that process for Doctor of Engineering students. We expect our Doctor of Engineering students to bring to us a project that's of importance to their workplace. And that's why we expect their employers to pay for their education through this program. So in that first year, before you apply, that year zero, students are working with their company to identify a project that's exciting, a research depth that will be of interest to Hopkins professors, and that is of importance to their place of work. At the same time, they're identifying somebody at their place of work that can serve as that co-advisor. And they put together an application to us, which includes a detailed research proposal explaining what it is they want to work on and why it's important to the company. That, together with letter of recommendations and the like, is put together into an application. I'll go into more detail about the application in a few minutes, but that's the gist of it. Create a research proposal and submit it along with your other documents for evaluation. Assuming the student is admitted to the program, they will come to Baltimore. Now, I mentioned that this is a non-residential program, but students are expected to show up in Baltimore twice a year, once in June and once in January. We start the program both in June and in January, so the two starts per year. But let's say for this example that the student starts in June. They come in June and they meet with their advisor and they sit down for what we call a diagnostic interview. The first step in the Doctor of Engineering program is we expect our students to learn something new, something important that is directly relevant to their project. And at that diagnostic interview, that's exactly what happens. They meet face-to-face with their advisor and they draft a syllabus of new material that they wish to learn. Because 6 months hence, at the next meeting in January, they're going to stand for the first examination on that new material. So, first step, meet with your advisor, work out a syllabus of new material. That new material that they want to learn is something important to the project. How do they learn material? Well, we have a large portfolio of online classes. If students happen to live in the Baltimore area, they're welcome to come to our face-to-face classes, or they can learn it through supervised reading. Your advisor would hand to the student papers and books that are relevant and discuss them weekly. And eventually, at the end of that first semester, they come back to Baltimore for their second in-person meeting where they stand for their preliminary examination. Now, during that first semester where they're learning all this new material, they can get started in their project. We don't mean to slow down the project research, but we do think it's important that students learn new material. The next semester, as they're developing preliminary results toward their research project, they are drafting a document that's a much more detailed research proposal than the one they submitted at time of application. The one at time of application can be somewhat general, somewhat pie in the sky, broad outline of what they are interested in, specifically how that's important to the company, But the nitty-gritty of what exactly they're going to be working on and what the accomplishments are going to be may be left vague at the time of application. But now is the time when preliminary results, references, and the like are put together into a much more detailed research proposal. And at the end of the first year is the second milestone exam, where students give a presentation on their project and then answer questions from a panel of professors. Passing that, they then begin in earnest working on their project. That can take up to another 2 years, and at the end of the whole process, they stand for their defense of their portfolio in which they present their research. So let me talk about the following two features of the Doctor of Engineering program, which have been alluded to somewhat before, but now I want to get more specific: the Supervisory Committee and the Semi-Annual Doctor of Engineering Conference. The Supervisory Committee is a panel of three individuals that's in charge of that student, that's going to help that student and guide that student through the research. First and foremost is the Hopkins Engineering Faculty Advisor. That's the main mentor for this research project. But there's also a mentor back at the student's home company that serves as co-advisor. We round that out with a third committee member who's determined at the time of enrollment, so that there's a third person to bounce ideas off of. This third committee member also serves on the various examinations. Now, I mentioned that students come to campus twice in June and January. We call that the semi-annual Doctor of Engineering Conference. And at that conference, they do various things. Students do various things, including stand for their various milestone examination, but they do more than that. There's a lot of networking and social events planned for these students, because we want Doctor of Engineering students to have a community where they meet each other and have a time to interact, learn what other people's projects are. We'll also have professional development events for them, be it something economic or something technical or something cultural, to help round out their education. Let's talk a little bit about the admissions criteria for the program. I mentioned earlier that we require a master's degree, and that's a technical master's degree, either in engineering discipline or something closely aligned, such as physics or mathematics. We want to see transcripts from both your undergraduate degree as well as your master's degree. Now, please bear in mind that we understand that some of those grades are quite old. A 45-year-old mid-career professional hasn't been in school for 20-plus years. That C that they got in organic chemistry as a sophomore, as an undergraduate, we're really not worried about that. We do want to see your transcripts, but we also want to know about what you've done since then to see if you're up to speed for this program. We do not require the GRE. That's not necessary for this program. The main thing that we want to see, of course, is that research proposal I discussed with at some length earlier, as well as a statement of purpose. That's a separate document that briefly explains why you want to pursue this degree. We want to know who you would like to work with as your Hopkins advisor. You could put one or maybe a few names of people that you perhaps have earlier contacted as potential advisors, the people that you would like to work with. We also want to see a letter from your company. Who's going to be your co-advisor? Do they support the program? Tell us a little bit about that person and their research credentials. Finally, we want two additional letters of recommendation. And what we're looking for there is testimony that you have intellectual depth, a willingness to work hard, and creativity. These applications are vetted both by our Doctor of Engineering Oversight Committee, which is a panel of professors that run the program, as well as the potential Hopkins advisor who eventually serve as the mentor. I just mentioned the Doctor of Engineering Oversight Committee and their role in the admissions process, but this group also serves two other functions. They monitor student progress through the program, as well as propose and approve revisions to the Doctor of Engineering program. For further information, please visit our website, and we look forward to receiving your application. If you need to contact either myself or Mia Brooms, who is our academic program coordinator, our email addresses are on your screen. Thank you so much for your attention. We look forward to receiving your application, and we hope to see you someday in our Doctor of Engineering program.